some far-flung islands on the other side of the international date line. They decided people's time zone, and they moved them from minus 10 to plus 14. Okay, sure. So, in application, if you don't specifically provide the time zone, this is not specific to Rails, but just generally, there are kind of three places that information could be set up. The operating system has a default time zone, that's often UTC these days. The database has a default time zone, and your application, depending on your framework, usually has a default time zone. In Rails, it does. Rails times all of these defaults in UTC, but in Rails, that's the one you probably want to actually change, because if you keep your system and database time zones in UTC, which is pretty common practice these days, but not long ago it wasn't, then Rails will store date times in UTC transparently, and if you set the default, then mostly good things will happen. So, like, if your company's only in California, and you have parts of your application that are only relevant to people in your office, it's sufficient just to use the defaults in those circumstances. So there are time zone-aware methods in Rails that will use them. In addition, however, if your application has users that aren't in your office, then your user model needs time zone information. And you should always store it and always use it. As an aside, I remember a few years ago there was a furious posting from a new user on the local SDPerby group about how, like, how do I fix this time zone information? And don't tell me to use date times and time zones. I don't want to do that. Crickets, because there was no actual answer to his query. We also have dates in the database. They do not have time zone. They don't have time at all, so they don't have a time zone. So there are perfectly valid use cases for dates. But just be aware that time-to-date conversion is problematic. So examples, a birthday doesn't have a time zone. Your birthday is, you know, September 22nd. No matter what time zone. So there's no time information with it. If you store that in the database, say with the user, don't get a time zone. Same with, for example, if you're building a calendar event, you have all day events, like whatever, then all day calendar events should not have time, because it doesn't matter what time zone you're in, the all day event is time. So, you know, ask yourself if the day in question changes if you're engaging. Does, if you have a time component, you can do that, if not, you can take it. So what you see all the time are things like, oh, I have some date times like that. That probably means somebody converted from a date to a date time without having time information. As I said, be very careful with that conversion, be very careful with building your memory, very good chance you can know exactly what you're doing. Something. So, what methods should you use? Well, just to let you know, if you use these time zone aware methods, you'll get nice stuff like this. Okay. As far as these two different time strings, are they the same? Yes. Because my local default time zone is daylight time. So we converted this way and this way to the time. You can see that it's the same. Kind of trivial, but a lot of people forget that time zone, of course. Time zone, of course, won't do that. So here are the time zone methods you should use. From now and go, I'm perfectly safe. Zone.parse print on both time and date. Have an instance, and you need to display it or something, you should use in time zone with an
within your system default, you can explicitly set it, say for every user model. This last one is sort of like the measure of warning. If for some reason you really, really need a timestamp on a day, you know that this is what you really want, you can return the time zone. Again, the problem there is you store these things, store days as times, you're very likely to get loads where somebody's in another time zone, the day comes back, and it shows up as things to specifically avoid. Time.now, day.today, time.parse, or without using. I kind of actually. Okay, so that was motivated by a particular thing called falsehoods programming for dates, which I will link to again. I recommend reading it. It's a laundry list of 100 plus things that seem perfectly reasonable truth statements that I'm not sure. And I forgot to put a slide on that. But for names, they're just simple. Name, full name, which is actually robot. At this point in time, have only one full name. Well, at this point in time, have one full name, which they go by. Because it does not change. None of those are true. This name has changed, but only at a certain set of events. Marriage or something. No. These names are assigned at birth. Not true. These names are written in ESP. Really not true. People's names are written in one single character set. These names are all mappable to code points. And two different systems contain the data about the same person. We use the same name for that person. So the takeaway from this is a lot of validations you might be tempted to do on names are probably not. So don't. You'll be turning away and rendering someone's name in the output, which is better than something previously you do. So if you can avoid the first name, last name thing, consider doing so. I understand a lot of business applications or tax software, whatever. You're dealing with government forms and you're dealing with people or something like that. But if you have just a social media site, a forum, a blog or something, why do you need to ask the first name, last name? It just constrains us to standard, you know, American arrangements. So why not just use a name field and be done with it? Rails makes this particularly easy these days because it gives you minimum validation. So this isn't all that hard. You just have to remember, don't just do as little as possible. Remember, it's impossible to guarantee that your answer is. We don't have any large companies that try to do that. As I said, Unicode. And just because you're US based doesn't mean you can assume this. Plenty of people in the United States do not have SPM. They may have something that you had to put down for various reasons. But again, you know, why enforce that if you don't need it? All right. Anybody have a fun? So for this one, just keeping to the US, obviously international addresses. Why would you think that? Even just in the US. Valid postal service addresses. So if you imagine a bunch of lines and then finally the whole line, this is the ability to street address and go to the city state. That's a valid one. Data into account. That's a valid one. Not safe. If you do anything with the territories of Puerto Rico, their format's complete. They can have organizations, condominium names, and building number, and residential name, which doesn't mean that people live in the name of the building. All of that common. Even in the US, you get these multi-line recipients. You know, Bob Smith, general manager, 12-4, mail stop. then this is less common as the post office is still having. A lot of this, once again, is simple non-over validation. This happens to me all the time. This is Southwest Airlines. That's not my actual address, but my address is in the airport. It says, well, it's not. Right? So they don't allow a slash in the hat on the screen. I've seen systems that run on dash, and other streets telling them to have dash. So standardized addresses may reduce the presence of characters, but they don't eliminate them. One simple example, this is about this is a Cork City. That's an in the standardized US format. As I said, this is an address. Zip codes. Okay. In general, again, even if you're US only, maybe don't. Some kind of optional validation that's actually in zip code. Your preferred relationship in just Canada kind of using zip code because the rest of the world calls them postal codes. Zip code is a trademark for postal service here in this country only. In Canada it's six often numeric letters with a space as it is in the UK, actually. You know, so like 12 or 13 or 14 alphanumeric, which is probably the sufficient globally, but not just 5 numbers. Some things I've run into with actual applications is, putting the zip code at this time is state. Not all the time. Most of the time, sure. Maybe that's good enough. But they don't. Those zip codes cross state boundaries. Because zip codes are not geographic. Postal route from the post office to the route that that carrier services goes outside the state line. So validating addresses. The short version is you can't. You can try, and you'll see this sometimes as a common JavaScript widget you'll see that these people valid addresses. There's also a USPS database. But you can't force that value. Has to be optional because they cannot have all addresses, even non-year ones, because new addresses pop up all the time. You can create new addresses at will. No one has to register those addresses with anyone. There's even bigger problems though. So the addresses are not always the same as the physical delivery addresses. Entire towns and communities have no physical addresses in the USPS database. And again, I'm not talking about edge cases. Very strange remote rural places that don't have the internet. We're talking Rancho Santa Fe does not have physical addresses in the USPS database because the post office only delivers to a central mailbox location because they don't want their post office trucks and employees going to their town. Mind you, of course, UPS and FedEx were the masters. So, but if you use UPS and FedEx to validate your addresses, they just pass it to the USPS and the USPS address is not valid. So now I'm just maybe seeing some simpler things. Money and currency. Monetary values. I hope this is obvious, but I see it time and time again. Never ever. You will have random issues. You can use decimal. But it's not totally without problems. So consider we have that product with the price that we made a minute ago. So it renders to JSON, back to JSON looks like. And then we do some math with it done in. We apply a discount and combine that rate times the price times quantity. That would make the rate, but it's not. Say the discount is also, say discount is also a little bit around where you can. So what are some ways to do that? Without that, you could just, for instance, that's sort of a typical problem solution. But in my case, this way, we're using energies everywhere, we're using around the others. So, yeah, make it price in a sense, and then only convert upon this value. And you don't have to use sense, had you know this, because you're doing the same kind of thing, and a few currencies around. But the good thing there is, unless you're doing it again, a handful of other currencies, the failure to convert display units is usually obvious because you're just going to go away. Whereas the rounding stuff won't be obvious unless you put it into the values. Email addresses. So just remember, email addresses can contain Unicode characters. That one, that's a real domain, their website. There are lots of top-level domains. You can't do the old, there's only these in the U.S., and then maybe we'll add Canada, UK, Australia, for no, there's sort of arbitrary ones now. You can validate that there's an at and a dot after that. That's about it. So, as everyone knows, I still see people trying to validate stuff like this. There's a lot more we could add, which I just mentioned in passing. Internationalization, I don't think you have to necessarily intend to ever actually internationalize that for it to be useful to put all your screens in your computer panels. Because doing that, even if all you ever do is US English, means they're all in one place, and if you want to change your configuration, you can hand that file. That's all they need to know how to do, right? So that's useful. And then it makes internationalizing your copy true. And people can do that on Fiverr for $10. Localization, this is more arguable. But if you have an inkling you might want to support, so do people know the difference between the two? Internationalization, broadly speaking, like, I have some strings, like some copy, like, I have uploaded for settings, and I want to put that in French and Spanish, and so on. That's internationalization. Localization is kind of the rest of it. Like, in German, you use, decimal points instead of commas to denote numbers, or currency symbols. This is probably less of a it's not that hard to just add a localization in every place in the helpers, like, for example, the great number of currency. You can pass in an option like that. So just do that. Why not put that on the user model and always pass it in? And then if you ever need to change it, it's all there. You don't have to go through your whole app and change it. It's very little experience. We all know, not to store it, credit card information, for most places that are small, obviously, definitely just use your service, and many of them are for studies and I started to put in a bunch of stuff in the calendar events, so I said, I would have it's easy to install it at all. Just if that's something that comes up, you're looking on the calendar, just be aware that that's an entire huge thing. So, in conclusion, the main takeaway is don't overvalidate. People have a real tendency to just stop. You do those only products, global life problems. And be a little bit culturally aware, just remember that your experience is not good. Right, and check out those links. So, any questions, comments? Yeah.
probably in the higher tiers.
That helps a lot, right?
Yes.
Sure. It may not help with what order you display them.
I definitely think that's confusing there.
Yeah, sure. Right. Exactly. Any other comments, questions? And again, so, you know, I'm kind of trialing this stuff here, so I'd love to expand it over time, to it, and eventually make it sort of also just like a repository that people can go to when these things come up. So if you have further things to add or suggestions on parts I went over, please do the information and let me know. Great, thank you.
So we're not using microphones, so wave if you can't hear us in the back. So this talk is an introduction to language expressions. I want to be really honest about this. It could also be called the Absolute Beginner's Guide to Language Expressions by Absolute Beginners. So just so you know exactly who you're talking to and who you're talking to. If you're going to be honest, you could also call it very scary things in programming. Definitely. So, you know a little bit about where we're going here. I'll just explain this within the context of who we are, where we work, our first day at Cal School. We're going to do a little bit of live coding to show you how powerful Lambda can be. Look at some of the technical stuff the actual definitions, and then make some recommendations from our bosses on how they could use and put the stuff up. We won't have some photos of kittens. Photos of kittens obviously are results. Okay. So this is me. I'm a graduate from the Academy. I've done a bunch of other things, including computational linguistics before being a developer. This is Daniel, who you'll notice couldn't be bothered to send me his photo. he's experiences in architecture and rocket and building a lab, which he did brilliantly. And House Four is our internship experience at Learn Academy. We're incredibly lucky to be there. We're quite an extended internship experience, so that's just on. We've got a little why. But the House Four is a startup. A little bit about them. So they're basically a software platform for service professionals like plumbers, electricians, carpenters, this kind of thing. So they provide customer relationship management software professionals who can use create invoices, send text messages to clients, set up appointments, this kind of thing. So it's something that's for smaller service companies. So this company was started by small people engineers before Colin and William, each other for 5 to 10 years. And the important thing about this is they really are software engineers and not developers. So their code tends to be computer science. Currently they want to turn around the funding, they have 40 technical. The engineering staff team is 8 engineers and 3 interns. 3,500 plus tests, which is every code that is written, you have to add to the test suite. And the code is put to production 7 times daily, and in fact, on our very first day, we put code to production. But anyway, so it's a very particular kind of environment, I think. And this is what we saw on our first day, which is clear enough. So here we've got some stuff about initializing headstarts, the successful backs and failure fallbacks and landers, and all this stuff. I think, to be honest, we saw this entire code base of stuff along with this. On our first day there, I understood this. And this is how we felt about it, basically. It was a tough introduction to the area. So why do you think you should know about lambdas? Well, I'm going to pass over the fact that lambdas, so we can do some line coding, so you see a little example of what they can do.
Thanks, Rebecca. Guys, let me just do a quick coding, live coding exercise, and this kind of for those of you that are more visual, so like I am. I'm going to do this up here. Yes, I'll preview it in there. All right. First, I'm going to start by writing a method. I don't want to find this, but a method is like that. If you define it, let's call it walk the dog. Right? Find a method, and then you like have it do something. And then the way you call it is you walk oh wait, Alright, so now you find it, now you call it. Walk, 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 right? There you go, look at it. Alright, so now I'm going to define a quick lambda just so you can see like the quick, like how they differ. So let's call it something like drive my car. So now as you can see, this is one of the first things we know about it. It is pertains to props. They're the same class essentially, it's just they do slightly different things. So now this won't run until I actually call it. So when you saw like the method, I do this, right? It runs it right. So let's see what happens when I just do this. Didn't do anything. What's that about that? So now let's actually see the way to call it. Drive. And then call it. Boom. There you go. There you go. That's better. You guys didn't say anything, you know. All right, cool. So, becomes a little bit more powerful when you actually use it as reusable code. So if you had a method that said, say, watch it. Let's have this one say, kind of lambda as a lambda. And then let's have a poly. And let's give it a parameter. So lambda is basically a block of code that you can pass parameters, and just like this much as you would a method. So let's say normal logic. There's no logic in here. Logic, 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 and then let's define a lambda. And it takes in a parameter, let's say a person. And then let's have it do something. Alright. Perfect. And that's all I know. Alright, so now what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna call that pass that lambda into that method and we'll see what happens. So that's gone. Pass in my lambda. Oh, and then so this doesn't seem like much, but it becomes very convenient for when you, let's say for example, you have a method and then you're passing a variable. Well, you want to execute the code on that variable to pass it in. It's sort of the same thing with lambdas. Let's say you have a method and you want to pass in different blocks of code. Well, you don't know what blocks of code you're going to pass, so that's when lambdas come in, because they're reusable, you call it one. They sort of work like modules where you can just throw them in there, execute them in that one method, and then it'll run as you can see right there. So, let's do one more example. Fine. Let's say, maybe virtual thing. Fine. Lambda was probably. Is that good? Yeah. Should have just played. Okay. So now this is what I was talking about. I'm calling the first method. So that. And then you pass it in. Right. Well, I'm going to pass it back to Rebecca now. Mm-hmm. That's my presentation.
Okay. So, I can give you a little bit of an idea of how useful it can be to have like these lambdas that can be passed around. So, just to go into a little bit of where they're situated within the syntax. So, we all know blocks, right? So, basically, the stuff in the code brackets here, that's a block. The stuff that's in the beach, sorry, the do in the end, that's a block. Those are not objects. They look kind of similar to a box and lambda, but they're not. So, then we have these two examples of blocks, a regular block and a lambda. You can see that the syntax is the same in both examples. So, you can have it to be expressed and called in both the same way. So they are, but these are actually objects and can be passed around as arguments to other methods. So they are closures, so for those who do want to develop JavaScript, which is a much simpler concept, and they enable you to, and then you can keep passing them around as arguments, and you can reuse the same code over and over again, which is really, really powerful. So, the big things to know are that they are objects. They can be assigned to a variable, as you saw. You created a lambda with assigned to a variable, and then you're able to pass it down to a bunch of different functions. Lambda checks the number of arguments blocks go. It's kind of a detail, not important. The crucial thing here is that lambdas that have a return statement return but do not return the enclosing function, unlike props. And this is useful. So here we have a prop, and so it's a little bit fuzzy. So in this method, there is a prop that gets called, and this code will never get executed when you run this function. This code will never get executed because the prop gets called, and there's a return statement from the prop. So basically, once the prop is returned, you're done. The enclosing function will affect it as well. Whereas with a lambda, you have this return statement inside the lambda, but it will continue on after that. The method will continue, and you'll have whatever code comes after the lambda will continue to run. So it's super powerful to be able to do something, you can do a whole bunch of stuff, you can return, and then still continue on with your code. So, actually, I put this up in the code. Okay, so, this is actually the code for the class call. This is a file with the lambdas defined for some of the integration partners. So, it's a big file of integration partners and and as you can see, they're actually using these. This is a file that goes with them, where they use these lambdas over and over again in different contexts. It's this really powerful way of defining code somewhere and then just putting it in when you need it. So we discussed this a lot with our bosses at Houseboard, and they feel like they're feeling about this now. They have lambdas all over the place historically. They're kind of moving away from the general, except for integration with partners. Things like integration with Google Calendar, integration with MailChimp, integration with QuickBooks. So they run their code and you just basically just vanilla. But when when they are going to do something with an API, something that is not dependent on their code base, something that interacts with some external service that can have all kinds of problems, they farm that out to Lambdas. And they feel that gives them real power to have control over their code and this very modular code, and then just have a bunch of functions that will go and look after integration and be quite separate from the rest of the code. And it makes the code modular and readable and maintainable. And it's pretty efficient if you're only doing that once. If you imagine you see things, this is maybe a bit of this file, but if you scroll down, you see that these things are used over and over and over again. So it's a really powerful and efficient way of writing code. So they might be in love, but we're still very scary. I'm going to be really honest. Every time I look at them, my eyes hurt. They are difficult. They're difficult. There's stupid ways, at least. There's a new way through the stabby lands. I have no idea why someone thought we should have yet another way of writing what we think is the method. I think we just stick to what we have to do. I don't know. They do not necessarily make the code easier to read. And they can be really complex. There's a lot of these success and failure fallbacks in our code base, which are just unpleasant. But in the right context, they are super powerful, very efficient, and they make your code super modular. So I think it's a really big step to go out and maybe use them before and start using them. But particularly if you're repeating a lot of code or making calls to the same methods over and over again, then this might be a really good thing to consider. So that's how we feel about using these days. Well, not really. So I'd like to thank our colleagues at House for having us here. As an old fan, all the other denizens of what's called the engineering fish tank. They were super patient, not only us as interns, but also in helping us prepare. And listening to his own complaints about our Lambdas many, many times. I have to think it says questions, but I'm going to be really honest. There's very few questions that I can answer. anyone here would like to answer?
Thank you.
Hi everybody, my name is Emma Costas, and I am from Houston, but I'm currently up in Bedford, Oregon, working for Google. I'm not alone here, thankfully. Is this the right size? Okay. So I'm a relatively new software developer. I graduated from Learn Academy in December, and I started working at Google as an apprentice in March. So I've been preparing for about 9 months, and in that time, I've done a lot of learning about programming and a lot of learning about learning in general. And I want to share some of my learnings about learning today. So by giving this talk, I want to give junior developers a roadmap for using it kind of efficiently to grow their skills. And I also want to give mentors a better understanding of where the people they're mentoring are at in their learning, so that they can better support and help them move forward without giving them challenges that are going to be too overwhelming or block them. So if you're going to take away anything from this talk, let it be this. People learn differently at different times of their learning. And looking at your learning in stages allows you to concentrate on the best way to learn for your skill level. The Dreyfus model I have found to be very helpful in breaking up your learning. It's a 5-stage model of how people acquire skills through formal instruction practice. It was developed for education and operations research by Dreyfus Brothers, so a picture right here. And they worked at UC Berkeley in 1980, but it's widely interdisciplinary. So these are the stages of the Dreyfus model. It moves from novice to advanced beginner to to competent to proficient to master. And now I have expert beginner off the track here because it's not actually a part of the business model, and comes from another study called the Dunning-Kruger effect. I believe it's significant, however, to how junior developers learn, so I have included it here today. And today I will just be talking about this section because once you're out of this section, you're not really a junior developer anymore. So novices are absolute beginners. This is their first introduction to the content, and they have no framework for what they're learning. So if any knowledge is like assembling a puzzle, this is when you take a look at the picture on the box, dump out all the pieces on the table, and begin flipping these over. You're not really putting pieces together yet. You're just starting to get a feel for what you're working with. And in our context, a novice would be familiarizing themselves with syntax and the basic building blocks of a language. So things like data types, variables, conditionals, etc. They're also learning how to think about content. So whether you're a visual, auditory, or kinesthetic learner, what's most important as a novice is you're not really doing anything yet. Rather, you're observing, following along, listening, and starting to build a foundation for understanding. There are lots of resources online these days to get started at this level, and many of them are free. A mentor isn't going to be too helpful to a novice. What they really need is an instructor or a teacher. But if you're a mentor who's not in a position to teach, you can still help a novice by evaluating and engaging their knowledge via conceptual quiz type discussion. So now a learner has built a foundation. Going back to the puzzle metaphor, you're probably starting to group and categorize your knowledge, like you would sort different colored puzzle pieces that probably belong in the same area. You might try and see if any of these colored pieces match, but you don't really know where they belong in your area. So this quote is from the book Pragmatic Thinking and Learning. They want information fast. They dismiss part of the big picture as irrelevant to them. They have no holistic understanding, and they don't really want it yet. So to move forward, an advanced beginner needs lots of practice. They should be doing lots of small-scale challenges, and these challenges are going to be more like write a program that does blank rather than building an application, even small ones. Pairing with more experienced developers is going to be really helpful at this time, but it's going to primarily look like code review and guided walkthroughs of the code that's already been written, with lots of discussion as to why things are the way they are. So advanced beginners are going to get stuck a lot. If you're helping an advanced beginner, they're probably going to be running up against a lot of things they've never seen before, and they probably don't know where to find the answer. Be available to help point them in the right direction. At this phase, my mentors and I struggled a lot with how much do you let someone struggle versus how much do you just give them the answer. And that's a balance that's probably going to vary based on the person. I know I favor getting the answer because then it's easier for me to kind of process. I'd rather discuss why than go spending hours on Google. In this stage, a mentor is more like a tutor. You're not spoon-feeding instructions to the learner, but you're probably guiding them through the next steps and educating them on the tools and tricks that they haven't seen yet. So now you get to expert beginner. We're off the track, if you remember. The expert beginner is much more capable of being independent, and for the first time, they're probably feeling like they've got it. They're learning to recognize patterns, they can solve problems, and they can do some debugging. But the expert beginner is off the track of the business model because they have a false sense of confidence. And this is called the Dunning-Kruger effect, which is a cognitive bias where relatively unskilled people mistakenly assess their ability to be much higher than they really is. They think they know it all, but really they only know what's been put in front of them, and that's a very limited area of the whole field. And some people do get stuck here. So to move out of this period of cognitive bias, an expert beginner should work on more advanced challenges that combine multiple ideas together. While doing this, they're also examining the programming language in the context of larger fully featured applications. Before they're looking at the code itself, and here they're dealing with applications like we use them in the real world today. They should practice refactoring and work for writing clean code and use constraints to find alternative ways to solve problems. They should also solicit code reviews from more advanced developers who can comment on their patterns and provide guidance and direction on how to refactor. So without a mentor at this point, to point them in the right direction, expert beginners are going to find that they have a lot of ways that work, but not acknowledge things outside of their scope. They're going to be This is where mentoring, in my opinion, is most essential. A mentor is able to give a learner insight into things that they'll see working as a professional, things to work toward, and things to avoid. By focusing the learner on refining how they work, they'll be able to move to competence. And a competent person is not done learning, but they're effectively a developer. They can function independently, and they know how to get unstuck because they've seen multiple approaches and are familiar enough with the resources to know how to look for answers. They definitely still need mentorship, but it's much less. And now what we really need is experience. They need to go and do. They need to build as many things as possible. For a competent developer, the best way to keep learning is to continue to interact with their peers, other developers working in the industry. Other than that, the path forward is building. And that's all I have for you today. But I have lots more to say on this subject. I would love to make this a full conference talk someday. So come and chat with me if you have any thoughts, and tell me how you learned best. Thanks for listening. Genetics or not genetics, so why or the what, why, and however you like that is. My name is Gina Chong. I am a student at Red Academy, where we are working on Ruby on Rails and JavaScript. I call it the village because the people there are incredibly amazing, and I could go on for days about how great my experience has been, but I'm here to talk to you about the Red Academy. So, what you can expect is we'll know about what they are, why you might use it, why you might want to dabble a little in it, and a really quick introduction on its syntax. So, getting started. These are expressions we use regularly. You guys know that one, TMI, depending what kind of friends you have. TIL, Redditors, and OG. The reason why I'm showing you these is because they're really easy on the eyes. Regular expressions, or not. That's what one looks like. So what are regular expressions? They are a way of describing a set of strings. Using these today, but we're going to break down what this actually means later on. All right. So why do we want to use regular expressions? Use them to validate input. You come across this a lot, right? You're creating a password for a user account and you think it's okay. You put it in and it's like, nope, I need a number. Okay, put in a number. Nope, I need a symbol. So that process could go on. What's really happening behind the scenes is it's actually taking the user input and it's checking it against a criteria that the programmer has provided in regular expression. You could use it to do things faster, like renaming a ton of files, and finding records in the database that are more or less consistent for them. And web scraping, which is a way to pull information from the source so you can do stuff. The syntax for regular expressions is portable, and what that means is it is the same across any language you use it with. The implementation, or how you're telling the language that you're using a regular expression, is going to be a little bit different. It varies, but the stuff of regex is the same. And it's smooth. And that's not a technical way of describing it. That's just how I describe it because it just comes up everywhere. When I started learning about regular expressions, I just
to saying, hey, here is a regular expression, and your zip code only can have three letters. There are two general rules for regular expressions. First one is you have to use it responsibly. And by that, it's because regular expressions, you can get carried away with it. A lot of people use them when you don't need to, because the language has only evaluated certain input. And then also, sometimes people get too clever with regular expressions. And we saw earlier that it's sort of hard to read. And so, found a comic that spoke to that. Here you have a fellow programmer who says, when he's drunk, he's looking at his rackets, and, or just his boots. You know, can't really tell the difference. That was yesterday's rackets. You also want to do this thing called avoiding asking to. It's a nickname for regular expressions, because it looks like that sometimes. And the other rule for regular expressions is you want to be as specific as possible. Mainly because regular expressions has tools to be able to match a lot of things. So the game with regular expressions is you have a set of things that you do want to match, and a set of things that you don't want to match. Getting started. You have actually used, most if not all, have used regular expressions in a very literal way. So when you're in a text editor, and you do command F for find, and you're doing something like ID equals provision in HTML. You're actually providing a regular expression. Each character that you're putting in there is a literal, meaning you're telling the Linux engine, you need to look for this pattern in this with these specific characters in this specific order. And so here you have literally in brackets, when you provide literals in a bracket, you're saying, find one single character, and it could be any of these. And then in regular expressions, we have meta characters, which signify a special thing to the Regex engine. And in this case, you're representing the same range of letters to be matched, but just you're representing it as a range. So you can do that for lowercase, uppercase digits, and then the slash D, it's a very common meta character, and also any alphanumeric and underscore. Some meta characters are classifiers, meaning if it follows a character, you are telling the Regex engine, this is how many times that character should appear. So let's say, for instance, you have an A followed by a star. You're saying that A should appear 0 or many times. Likewise, you have a plus mark, 0 or 1 times. And then a period here is that powerful tool where you can match any character, including the So, breaking down how to validate an email address. So every regular expression begins with forward slash. And these characters are commonly used to signify how a regular expression should begin and how it should end. So here, it's providing a selector and it's saying, okay, well, in this position, right, in the top, could be any of these characters, A through Z, number, underscore, period. I forgot to mention that if those meta characters are being interpreted or trying to be matched in a literal way, they should be escaped from that flat. And a hyphen. You also have quantifiers that indicate, again, how many times characters should appear. So you have a plus, in this case, it's a one little of time, and then here you have 2 to 6, that's minimum of 2 characters, maximum of 6 characters. And then your literals, so that at symbol and your period. So some sources that I used when I was teaching myself regular expressions were Regex 1, really good tutorial, that's one of the challenges, super interactive. I got that one happen. Rubular, which is a really cool regular expression editor, I found it really helpful just to test my strings and to be able to see how they match immediately. And Regex Golf, that is a Candy Crush for programmers, super addictive. And here are some videos that I found super helpful. And just to recap, Regex is a way of describing a set of strings, being used for validating input and syntax. That's it. Any questions?
Thank you.